Really pleased to have everybody here. We'd like to spend an hour roughly, and maybe could be less. If it bleeds over, that's fine too, to kind of talk about where we are with respect to our project. We are very excited, kind of just in the abstract, to give you sort of an overview. It's always nice to be able to say that we're on time and we're on budget, and we're on both of those at this point. We are still looking at December opening of the new high school for next year, looking at building our school calendar for next year that would include 2 days for the high school and middle school attached to the winter break to be able to make the move. But we're actually hoping that given the speed to which and the lucky weather conditions that we've had so far, that we might actually be able to take possession of the building maybe even sooner. But not move in probably until that December date. If you've been out on the website, and we'll share the website information with you again later this morning, we do have multiple live feed cameras that are out there. They've become sort of my screensaver. Hey, come on in. Good morning, Dennis. They've become my screensaver, and they are live feed cameras that show the construction site sort of in real time. And where we are now is we have completed the vast majority of the excavation that needed to be done. We took out 50,000 yards of dirt, which was represented 5,000 truckloads of dirt for the excavation for the whole of the larger portion of the high school, which is the right-hand side, which is affectionately known as the fat bar. That bar actually goes down below grade two levels. That first level is we have the arts area, we also have the locker rooms, and then we also have wrestling and the fitness area. And then the next level up from that is where we begin our gym level. So that excavation has been completed. And in addition to that, the foundation walls all the way around have been poured in place. And we are almost complete with the entire portion of slab on grade at this point. So the inside of the foundation walls are almost complete. The ground slab is almost complete as well. And Jack, I forget what the last piece, there's one piece just on the left-hand side that needs to be done. I think that happens in the next week or so.
Hey, good morning, everyone. So there's one section of slab on grade which we should pour tomorrow. And that'll complete the slab on grade for that lower level. And then there's a small section of foundation wall that we're still waiting to pour, which should be by Friday of this week. So end of this week, we should be done with everything below grade as far as concrete goes, and then shifting into steel. So
today, if you were to go by the site, one of the things you'll see is a very, very large crane that is a new fixture on the site, and that's where using the language that Jack has shared with me, they'll be swinging steel probably in the next day or so. So we're really excited about that. The reason that it's important to sort of talk about the foundation and the excavation and the like is because that is that was moving into this process probably our greatest risk. As you may recall, for those of you that have been in the system for a while, when Mary Ellen Henderson was built a decade ago and got into the foundation development and sort of the digging of the dirt, they found some really poor soils down there, and as a consequence had to do some undercutting and some remediation of the soil, and as a consequence the cost went up. And so in this particular circumstance, we did some really good soil bores before the project, so we had a good sense of what was down there. And the good news is we found nothing in the dirt. Everybody kept asking at each of the board meetings, did you find anything? And we're very excited to report that nothing was found. Oh, here it is. So thanks for throwing that up, John. So there's the very big crane. That's one of two cranes that are gonna be on site where the steel will go up. But this area is the slab on grade that I was talking that isn't quite done. This was done yesterday. This has been done now for a while. And you see that footprint, and that footprint is the footprint for that larger right-hand side as you're looking at the building. What's really exciting to me is to begin to sort of envision what the site is going to look like, the way that it flows with other things that are happening. So you may remember from some of the renderings, there were two tunnels that came out of the building and onto the field. This is where one of them will move out from. and this is the other. And this is really close to the grade now of the football field or stadium field at the school site. So on the right-hand side, that's where chorus, band, the black box, practice rooms are going to be. There'll be a training room down here on the front lower right. We've got dressing rooms that will sort of take up the rest of the middle of the building, and then on the far left-hand side, that's where the wrestling room and the fitness area are going to be. You'll see some grooves in the top of the concrete, and those grooves are where some of the steel is going to sit, and then it will just go up from there. And it's really exciting. They've started the backfilling, so you'll see that used to go all the way. Those went all the way down, and that dirt wasn't there, but they're starting the backfilling, and the site's coming along. So with that, sort of just context-wise of where we are, maybe we could flip back to the presentation, and we can show you from a schedule perspective where we are. And for that, I'll turn it over to Deisy, and I'll flip over. There we go. So Deisy, here you go.
Good morning, everybody. So this is a very familiar fabric. We've used, graphic. We've used this to illustrate kind of the process that we've been going through throughout the project. So Peter, do you want me to click through?
There you go, I just moved
you. Yep, so this is where we are right now. It's a little bit deceiving because it's like, well, we're so far along, but you're only showing it this far. Well, when we expand into kind of what construction and the design entails, this is where we are. We're about one third of the way. We're 18 months of construction, which is actually really, really quick for a 300,000 square foot building. We've gone through, it took us a little bit more than 12 months to do design, which is also really quick for a project of this size. We're still finalizing a couple of details, which is not atypical at this point, especially in school construction, as we continue to engage all the end users and stakeholders. Even this week and last week, I think we had, and over the last three weeks, we had another half a dozen meetings with performing arts, band, theater, special education, just to reconfirm things like furniture placement and outlet placements, that type of thing. So we're a third of the way. Permit documents, the only thing that's outstanding is final approval of our, what we're calling our phase two site plan submission, which is what we've coined the trapezoid, which is the parking lot on the east side of the property and the growth plaza that's gonna be in the front of the school. Other than that, we have our building permit. We worked close in hand with city planning and zoning and also planning commission to work through that approval. And this is showing August 2021 completion because there will be site work that will be completed, that trapezoid and plaza area. The school building will be complete in December of 2020 with first day of school opening January 4th or 5th, I believe is what we're looking at, of 2021. And then from January 2021 through August of 2021 will be the site work completion, working hand in hand with the economic development as they need to demolish the existing school building once we move out of it. So I had actually included in here the two videos, and when this is posted, you're able to click on it. The links are also posted on the FCCPS website, but there are two cameras with slightly different angles showing you the progress of it.
And there actually was a third camera mounted yesterday on the concession stand back by the stadium field, so you'll be able to see it the other direction as well, so you'll get a nice sort of robust view of the site and be able to watch it come along.
So this is the monthly report that Gilbane issues us every month. It's a great snapshot and summary of what's been happening in the project, all of the activities that we've been working on, both from a design perspective as well as a construction perspective. Gilbane does a great job of including kind of these detail really in the job site images, so you can see the concrete rebar insulation as well as the foundation walls. This is September 2019. It gets issued to us on the 15th of the following month. So this is the latest one we have. We'll be getting another one in about a week or two.
And when you go to our website, we do post these every month, so they're all up there and for anyone to look at. But it's a good opportunity for us to kind of also see what are some of the upcoming milestones to see where we're headed. And then also, I like the timeline because it it sort of makes it a little more clear. Although we're a third of the way through, it doesn't look like we're a third of the way through, but there are some things that will sort of move along rather quickly as we make our way.
Yeah, and one of the things with construction, which like Founders Row is a great example, is you're walking by these construction sites, you're like, wow, it's taking them forever. We always say coming out of the ground is the longest effort. Once you're out of the ground, like the building just seems to go up overnight. So that's really where a lot of the effort has gone in. So this is just a recap for those of you that haven't attended some of the school board meetings of what the project entails, just to have transparency. We're still at $120 million total project value, $108 million GMP for Gilbane, $9.3 million soft cost, which includes some of the kind of inspections and testing contractors that we had to hire under the owner's budget, and as well as the $2.7 million for financing and bond costs.
And I know sometimes acronyms can be hard, so I'll interpret GMP as greatest maximum price. And so that's the contract we got into with Gilbane that says the $108 million is the greatest maximum price that they can charge us for the work that's being done, barring some sort of unforeseen circumstance that neither they nor us have control over. So if we have delays that extend beyond sort of what are built in, sorry, Kristen. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I was curious on the financing costs, since interest rates have come down, did you get any benefit from lower financing and bond issuance costs?
The city will reap those benefits. We are locked into the $108 million amount. So the savings will actually come to the city, but the amount of price that we're paying will remain the same. I don't know if that answers your question or not, but
kind of sort of seems like the schools should benefit from that in some regard.
I don't necessarily disagree, but we're all on the same team. So yes. The good news is that someone will benefit. Yes, sir.
So Peter, the greatest maximum price, does that essentially freeze the project? If you come up with new requirements, yeah. Would that be over and above that 180?
That's a great question. The answer is yes and no. It depends on how big of an idea we have, because we do have built into that $108 million some contingency. So there's design contingency. So for example, if Gilbane recognizes that maybe something is drawn not exactly right and they didn't put in a wall where it needed to be, they would hit their design contingency and utilize that money, which is in that $108 million. We also have some owner's contingency that's in there as well. So if, for example, and this is a good example of how I think we're going to use some of the owner's contingency, one of the things we're looking at is instead of doing the standard flush toilets, we're thinking about using the motion sensor toilets. There are some backside costs to that with batteries and things like that, but swapping out that plumbing hardware will be an additional cost to the schools, but we'll utilize some of the owner's contingency for that, which is part of the $108 million. If we were to make a decision that we wanted to add another story, for example, to the building that exceeded what our owner's contingency would be, then it would exceed that 108, and we'd have to go back to the council for authorization for more money. At this point, we're locked, and in many ways, the design, because we're locked, is baked as well. So we're kind of in that lane where we're headed towards December opening and aren't going to make a whole lot of modifications at this point, because we really do want to stick within that GMP. Sure.
So this is just a breakdown of what Gilbane's contract breaks down into, just to have an understanding of it. We gave them an initial agreement, $6.5 million. We added another $1.25 million just to be able to continue with design. We gave them the first batch of the GMP, which allowed us to start construction in June of this past year. That was $32.65 million. And it released all of our early trades. So all of the work that you're seeing happening now, that's what that released. And it allowed us to stay on time. And then we issued and approved the final GMP in September, just a little bit over a month ago, within that $108 million. And as Peter mentioned, it includes a couple $100,000 of owner contingency. Just if we want to make those changes, they can move faster. we can be efficient in that process.
The good news about releasing that early GMP one, you know, given the current climate and not understanding what the lay of the land was, particularly like around steel, there's a lot of conversations out there about tariffs and the like. It allowed us to buy steel early before anything perhaps was going to kick in.
This is just a recap, just so that everyone's aware of just the amount of engagement that we've done over the past 18, almost 24 months of just engagement for the design. We've met with various student groups. We continue to engage with them. Our communications manager from the Brailsford and Dunleavey Hanscom team is actually working directly with Principal Hills and the assistant principals to coordinate with yearbook, things like time capsule, the legacy items. So all of those items, we're making sure that we're engaging the student community so that they have ownership in the new building. Interagency coordination, as we mentioned before, this is just a sampling. We kind of tried to lump it into a few categories to fit it into the slide of all the various user groups that we've engaged with from a design and end user perspective, including at the facilities level, central office level. So folks like John Brett and Dang and Sevi to make sure that, you know, food service, to make sure that everything is being captured for the design. And of course, our community meetings at various times, including ASAC. And we're going to show you a couple samples of all the great things that we've accomplished with the ASAC team.
Another acronym. So that's the Architectural Selection Advisory Committee. So that's the team. Hey, Shauna. Good morning. School board member Shauna Russell, everybody.
So I know it's not the last item, but I'm just curious what the, I guess, driver for consulting the yearbook and journalism, that those two specific student groups.
So on the journalism side, they've actually approached us more than we've approached them. So we've had a couple students reach out. They're writing articles or doing research on the school building for various topics. I think one student was focused on the sustainability question about net zero. Another student was just asking in general, I believe she was a freshman, just in general about the project, how it's going.
Her article actually came out yesterday.
Okay, yeah. Great. Yeah. And then with respect to, I just gave the examples of yearbook and journalism. So with respect to, for example, the time capsule that's been identified, we needed to identify an initial student group. It's not to keep anyone out, anyone who wants to participate, but in conversations with Principal Hills and the assistant principals, that was kind of the initial group identified. And then we actually drew this whole diagram when we had a brainstorming session 2 weeks ago of all the interconnecting pieces and how we kind of bring them together and create this new interest group. We're talking about student ambassadors. So one of our lead credits involves providing tours of the building once the building is complete. The best way to do that is to start educating students as early as possible while the building is being built. So we're working on setting up that kind of program and curriculum to start teaching them about the building, all the sustainable features, the structural elements. There's actually a really cool structural kind of form to the building that we were able to have that double story volume of the gym below grade with four levels of academic above it, and why all the beams and trusses are the way they are.
So here's an example of what you're talking about. This is actually this is structure here. Yeah. That's why you see those beams, because it kind of hangs.
So it's just working in all of these different elements. And we could do it in a silo, and all the adults could sit in a room and say, okay, we're going to come up with the curriculum, and we're going to do this. But it creates a lot more ownership with the students if they're involved with it and if they have say in it, and if they actually kind of start thinking about how are they going to tell the story. So when there's a lot of interest in this project from the size of it, net zero, geothermal, urban density. It's actually getting a lot of attention nationwide. So we have groups like CMAA, which is Construction Management Association of America, I believe, DCAIA, CAE, which is the Architectural Institute Committee on Architecture and Education Design. There's just a bunch of different other acronyms that have a lot of interest in doing tours of this building. And as we did when we were selecting architect and selecting a general contractor for this building, we went to tour schools that had examples of what we were looking for. So future schools that are going to get built are going to come here and tour it. So it's just these multiple opportunities for students to really become ambassadors of the school and the building, and it creates pride and also kind of a sense of ownership to take care of it.
But at the end, well. But at the end of the day, we're trying to engage as many groups as possible. So those were just some examples. So I'm gonna talk through some of these renderings, because these are actually becoming more and more real, which are exciting. So the Architectural Selection Advisory Committee is a group of people that have come together that are representative of the community to talk about things like color schemes, fabric choices, decisions around types of flooring and the like. And so what you're seeing here is some of the decisions that have been made already. So this one on the upper left is the entrance. When you first come into the building, on that through that main door, what you'll see on the right-hand side is, and the art may change and the graphics may change a little bit, but what you'll see is a wood wall that has a recessed sort of red, it's called phenolic, I think it's a phenolic wall, which is kind of a hard wall, sort of recessed, and then sort of a large gray area, potentially with just George Mason High School in the middle of it. The one idea that sort of was exciting to me as I was looking at that is it looks like a large sort of chalkboard when you walk in, and it just sort of speaks school to me. Chalkboard, some of you might remember what those are, but it looks like a chalkboard to me. So that's exciting as you walk in, and what you're looking at now on this flooring, this is going to be polished concrete on this floor. So when you come in, it will be a polished concrete floor, and then on the right, perhaps some sort of historical pictures and some things that sort of speak to the site itself. And then as you're looking up towards the end, one of the things you might remember in the design is that there's a central staircase that goes from the top floor all the way down to the ground floor. It's been called sort of the spine of the school, but you see, you can see through the treads, and that's important because we want to be able to see the light come in. That's one of the things you'll see in here is there's a lot of light that sort of permeates this building, but you see that central spine and then that sort of bridge across the top to the right with the black sort of corner look here, that's the cafe. So that's a place where students will be able to come, grab and go some food. And then as you turn that corner going that direction is the media center. So you'll see the media center windows actually appear in the double height space. Those look out over this sort of commons area, but that's where the media center is. If you go down a level from there as opposed to going up, then you go right into the gym level. And that gym level is pretty spectacular too. On the right hand side, what you'll see are some things that are starting to sort of come along, and that is, what is the furniture solution going to look like in the building? This may not be exactly what it looks like, but we have a designer, an interior designer, Katie from the architectural firm that has been working with us on solutions, working with the teams around solutions for different spaces. So you'll start to see some of the furniture and equipment that will start to populate. But this is the fourth floor collaboration area that you're looking down upon. So there'll be some big open spaces where students can sit and congregate, they can work together. And then in the top picture, if you look down a floor and all the way at the end, what you're looking at is a glassed-in conference room. So it's another space for students to be able to go and collaborate, or teachers to go and collaborate. And then on the bottom, this is that learning stair that we've talked about all the way through. And this is really starting to shape up to be something very special, I think, this area. And it's going to be called the Innovation Commons. It's kind of what we've called it all along. But what makes this area sort of special to me is it's another space where we can do large format group conversations. Students can sit and eat lunch. They can work independently. They can work in groups, whatever the case may be. Sitting on that stair, or there'll be a furniture solution in there. The bridge that sort of across the top, we've been in conversations with the Ed Foundation to think about what that could look like with respect to maybe even being some sort of indoor, I don't want to call it a greenhouse, I don't want to call it a vivarium either, but it's an indoor space where perhaps we can do some vertical farming. As you may know, we have a hydroponics and aquaponics program at our high school. But how might we highlight some of that work and sustainable farming and food in that top space. And then as you look down on the bottom left, one of the things you'll see is that's actually a see-through garage door. And it leads into a space that's about 3,000 or 1,500 square feet. So it's a very large space that at this moment is not programmed for, which means that we can do all kinds of different things in there. It can be a space to do a robotics exhibition, for example. So if you wanted to roll that door up and do some work in there with a robot, and kids can look at, stand on or sit on the stairs and sort of observe. I envision like a night of Battle of the Bands, you know, where there's some band going, stuff going on in there. I can see sort of Shakespeare in the Park happening there. There's a lot of stuff that can happen in that innovation common space that's really exciting. So moving on to the next slide, this is beginning to sort of take form also. And this is sort of the look and feel of what the auditorium is going to look like. So Laura, you were on the ASAC last night. Kristen was there. Jack, were you there last night?
Yeah.
Jack was there. Daisy was there. But the ASAC committee started to look at different solutions for what the auditorium will look like. And one of the things that I think has come through in this ASAC has been every decision that they've made has sort of been, I think, rooted, and I'm trying to put words to it, but it's like class, elegance, and sort of timelessness has sort of been the way that they've approached this work. So you're not going to see really bright pops of color, like big yellow or big bright highlighter green throughout this building. It's going to really be sort of classy and timeless. And this selection is, you'll see sort of, again, this auditorium space is going to seat 600 people, which is about 150 more than our current auditorium seats. But you'll see the acoustical tiles on the ceiling. This is looking back. So there's a secondary set of seats that kind of goes back into this space and a kind of a wood area to sort of set it off. One of the things you'll see is that this wall is actually tapered. So it's not a box exactly or a rectangle, but it's tapered back. And it's a little bit hard to see here. But the way that they've tapered it, it's got sort of multi-dimension, so it's got some texture to it going back this direction, some really nice vertical lighting that's more for accent than anything else. There's cans in the ceiling, there's cans in the overhead here, and then this floor is going to be carpeted underneath the seats, I think, is concrete with a particular kind of paint.
Yeah, it's a high-performance coating.
A high-performance coating goes underneath the seats, but this will be carpeted. And then as you look towards the stage, you'll see, so the proscenium opening is going to be surrounded, wrapped with wood. There'll be a flat stage as opposed to a rake stage. And then the floor of that will be painted black. And then they were looking at sort of a gray curtain and curtain type there. So that proscenium opening is, I think, 50 feet. Side to side, which will accommodate a band of almost 100. It accommodates the shows and the like. But I think one of the things you'll see here is sort of that, it's sort of timelessness. You know, it's not going to be really poppy in color. And then we've got some gyms. And this is where we start to brand ourselves a little bit. So when you come in the door and you see George Mason on the right-hand side, that's where some of the branding starts. But when students come to play us in basketball or volleyball or whatever the sport is, we want them to know that they're at George Mason High School. And so you'll see some of the branding that's starting to take shape. So this is the main gym. The main gym will seat 1,500 students. So as we grow, if we want to have all the students in the gym, we certainly can. You'll see the middle of the floor has the art, and then the out of bounds is wrapped with a red stripe, and you'll note that the bleachers are all red and then the pads are red as well. As you look out those doors, you're looking upon sort of a patio area that will overlook the stadium field. So just to kind of orient you a little bit to what you're looking at. The height from floor to ceiling is really high. It's like 35, 40 feet,
yeah.
Something
yeah,
like that. And then it does have these bulkheads over the seating areas that will help with lighting and the like. And then this is just another view. So that's looking out towards the field. And then this is looking back towards the hallway So as you walk down that central spine to the hallway, here's what you see. One of the really fascinating things I think that will be fun to kind of play with is that there's a walkway that Deisy's sort of pointing to now that leads to the auxiliary gym. And what it leads to is a track in the auxiliary gym, and I'll show you that in just a second. But that will be a really cool place, I think, to catch some basketball games or volleyball games or whatever the case may be that's happening in there. But you'll see some of the art. You know, you see the Mustangs up there. And so we'll see what that actually ends up looking like. But Kristen, you were going to add something to that?
That's a graphic example. That's
yeah, right,
not the
right.
actual graphic that
graphic
will be there.
Graphic example.
Right.
But the striping plan, the bleachers, the emblem in the middle are and the wall colors are starting to really look like that's what it's going to look like, yeah. are really going to pop. All right.
This space, just to add, as we were talking earlier about educating the students and, you know, creating knowledge about the building, these soffits here, if I can find where the pointer is.
Hey, Katie, we're down here.
These soffits right here, this is actually where a lot of the mechanical systems for, I believe, this floor and the floor above are housed. Because we are aiming to be a net zero building and we needed to preserve all of our roof space for PV panels, all of the mechanical systems are inside the building, so we needed to find somewhere to put them. And it's a lot of mechanical systems, so this is where they're housed.
So
it's a double function.
In the same regard, I assume the LEED program is kind of helping with the selection of materials on the inside, especially mm-hmm. as it relates to noise absorption.
Yeah, so there are...
A little tidbit for the student ambassadors.
Yep, absolutely.
And then here is that auxiliary gym that was leading from that upper area. And so if you were to walk across, you would see this really super cool guy here walking the track. But this is an indoor track. That's funny that they gave him sunglasses.
Yeah. His future's so bright, he's got to wear shades.
Oh, is that what it is? Okay. So this is an above the gym track that we can use for exercise. It'll be open to the community throughout the year as well, so the community can use it, but it overlooks the gym. Here you'll note the striping pattern is sort of the opposite of what was in the other gym. So in the main gym, it was a red boundary. This is a black boundary. And this gym will seat about 250 people. So we'll be able to play competitions in there, have competitions in there if we need to. So we thought, you know, if we have a JV basketball game at the same time as a varsity basketball game or something, we can do both at the same time. The significant difference between this gym and the other gym is the length of the court. This court's 84 feet, and then the main gym, it's 94 feet. 94 feet is the official VHSL state competition floor. VHSL allows you to play on an 84-foot floor, and it's totally fine to play any VHSL competition there. You just can't play state tournaments. So it does open up the possibility for us to host some competitions down the line. So that's the auxiliary gym, again, looking out towards the field. And then this one is looking back towards towards the hallway. Some of the bathroom designs are starting to bake as well. You might recall this building is going to have a combination of both binary boys and girls or men's and women's restrooms, and we'll also have some any gender restrooms throughout the building. And so as you walk into this particular restroom for any gender, you can come in. These toilet rooms will be full height stalls, and then with the wash up area in the back. And then this is the men's and women's or binary, and you come in and the wash up area is in the front, and then you go to your side. This is an opportunity for us to, again, kind of brand if we want. So you'll see some paint on the left-hand side. That might be a pop of red, and it might have a girl or a boy on it, whatever the case may be, to kind of identify which direction you would go. These toilet rooms are on the third and fourth floor. These toilet rooms are on the third, fourth, and fifth floor. And then on the lowest level, on the gym level, on the first level, and on the second level, there are binary bathrooms. So there's boys room, girls room. So these any gender restrooms will only be on 3 and 4. We will have some single stall on each of the floors below, but these are sort of larger gang style bathrooms. This is the website that we I mentioned earlier. That if you have a chance to go to, it really houses a ton of information. It's got all of the meetings that we've been holding, videos from those meetings. We're actually taping this one as well, recording this one, so it'll go up. But it's also got the live camera feeds. It's got all of the slide decks that we've shown to people. Talks about all the meetings that we've held, who we've met with, and the like. And we would really encourage you to go to that. Katie is here, just by the way. I just had mentioned you. Katie is our interior designer who's having to sort of work with us this year on our classic, elegant timelessness and trying to move away from... she's got great ideas, and she's been very helpful. I'll just leave it at that. So thank you for your work. So this kind of orients you again. When you get onto the website, there's Q&A. We've gotten a lot of questions and answers. We've gone through. We've answered every single question that we've gotten. We also have a place that you can input questions or also an email account, newgmhs@fccps.org, and any other questions that you might have. There are a couple of things that I want to touch on that are sort of important to the project, but aren't necessarily in this presentation. And the first is that I just want to say thank you to the community of folks around being able to sort of sort through parking and circulation of the site. I think that was something that, it definitely kept me up at night over the summer, trying to figure out what was site circulation at the school going to look like, how are we going to handle the parking situation. And our folks have done a brilliant job, I think, getting signage out there, and it didn't take long, maybe a couple of days, for people to recognize where they needed to park. The really great news is we have the same number of parking spaces we had before. We have 400. But the even better news is that we actually have learned that we don't use all of those parking spaces. There are about 50 vacant spaces each day. So if you went up to the site and you looked to the left of Mary Ellen Henderson back towards where the softball field used to be, there's a lot of sort of vacant parking area. So the good news is we're seeing some of our the fruits of our labor of asking people to walk, ride share, ride bikes, sort of paying off. The second thing that I want to just sort of contemplate a little bit is that there's going to continue to be I think there's just no way around some of the disruption on the site. So for example, there's a sanitary sewer line that's going to go in to what will be Mustang Alley. So the drive that comes off Haycock and goes towards, currently goes back towards the field and around by the cafeteria into Henderson. Over the next several weeks and couple of months, I think there's going to be some work that's going to be done in that road. So there are going to be times where one of the lanes is going to be blocked off, but we'll have some safety procedures and protocols in place to make sure that students and staff will be able to get through there safely. You may have noticed that on the back side of that road towards Virginia Tech, where the old Mustang wall, the mural used to be, there was quite a bit of work done behind that wall, and that was a consequence of the 10-acre site. They needed to put in what's called a duck bank, and essentially this duck bank holds all kinds of utilities and the like. And so that duck bank is complete. Now that that's done, we'll start the work in Mustang Alley. So that's the next piece that's going to be a bit disruptive to us, but we'll be able to work through that. When we open in December, that will be our next challenge, because there will be a period of time where some of our parking is actually going to slide from where it is currently onto, they will be tearing down George Mason High School. And once it's torn down, there will be some parking on where the site of George Mason is that will be available to us as a school to use temporarily while they're into a portion of our space developing the 10-acre site by EYA PN Hoffman. So we will be really sure to get as much information out as early as possible to make sure that everybody's aware of that. But it's going to continue to be a challenge, although I will say, as challenging as we thought it was going to be, it's actually gone relatively smoothly, all things considered. The last piece is, and Tim is here, Stevens from in all of his multiple roles, but we have the geothermal bores start when? Pretty soon. Oh, we're waiting to hear. But soon, soon, and when those geothermal bores begin, there will also be sort of a groundbreaking for the geothermal field as well, sort of celebrating that we are going to be a geothermal school. And it's not a hybrid system either, and that's something that's sort of come up a couple of times, is do you need both systems? And this is just going to be a pure geothermal building. We will be net zero ready. And again, what that means is the infrastructure will be there so that we can go out, and we're going to get into what's called a PPA, which is a power purchase agreement with someone. We don't know who yet. We're waiting to hear what our neighbors in the big county next door are doing. They had an RFP that went out, and we'll be able to potentially ride the contract that they've developed to get into a power purchase agreement with somebody who will then come in and put the solar arrays or the PV arrays on the roof for us, that will then reduce our amount of energy used in the building. So we're excited about that. And the last thing I'll say, and sort of related to that, is the instructional programming that's going to happen in the building is going to reflect, I think, the values of the building. And what I mean by that is when you walk in, you didn't see it, but as you go down that hallway to the right, there will be a relatively large screen, probably the size of this, that will be sort of an energy monitor. So students will be able to come in and see how is the energy of the building being used. It'll see how much PV energy is being captured. We're going to be able to see CO2 readings. We're going to be able to see a lot of different aspects of the building on that screen, sort of down on the, I think it's on the right. Is that right?
I believe so. I know we've got like three or four screens showing different information.
Yeah. So it's, I think it's on the right. It'll either be the right or the left. And then in that vivarium or that green space, we'll have a secondary screen that will show the same information. And so we really want to use the building as a teaching tool to really speak to our values around sustainability and the like. And I will say, since Dennis is here, one last thing, and that is in the front of the school where the trapezoid is, there's going to be a garden area. And that garden area, we're calling it sort of the grove. We're going to take the bricks and the plaques and many of the artifacts that are currently at the George Mason site and bring those over and put them in the grove, so that we will not lose all of the memorabilia and stuff that's been outside that recognize students for a variety of reasons at the old school. We'll be bringing that to the new school. And we're also going to bring over somehow, some way, the Mustang that's in the floor, and we're trying to figure out how to get that over to the new school in a way that it doesn't crumble and fall apart. So that grove, huh?
Gilbane has a plan.
But the grove where students can come and congregate will incorporate the bricks, the plaques, and will serve as a memorial garden, essentially, for past and previous staff and students. So. So with that, we would welcome any questions that you might have, but we're well on our way, that's for sure. Andy.
I have two questions. One is, so we've been lucky with the weather and the site conditions. What is the risk going forward? Like, when do we not have to worry about the weather?
Mm. Jack, you want to take that on?
Yeah, sure. So just to give you a kind of an overview of what's coming next. So like we talked about, concrete below grade is finishing up. We're going to start steel, so you'll start to see the structure go up. Starting at the beginning of this coming year, so end of January, early February, we'll start the actual exterior skin of the building. And then we'll work kind of, concurrently up with our mechanical systems and that sort of thing. So to answer your question, when is weather not a factor? Usually, you use the date that the building's fully enclosed, which right now we're looking at the end of August of next summer. That being said, there's a lot of things that we can do to help with keeping the building dry if we need to on a temporary basis to keep things moving. We also have it scheduled that we're working on structure throughout the winter. So steel can still go in, concrete decks can still go in, as long as it's not. Yeah, I mean, it's slow, right? If it's, anyone doesn't want to work outside if it's below 20 degrees, but as far as actually physically being able to get the work done, it doesn't stop us. There are some limitations when we can pour concrete if it gets too cold. But again, those are going to be kind of intertwined with the steel structure that goes in, so there's stuff that we can kind of leapfrog with.
Jack, is it also fair to say that there is some float in the schedule that Gilbain has built in to accommodate?
Yeah,
we're not banking on great weather. We anticipate, they've got a pretty significant snow budget, actually.
That was
a bit of a point of contention.
Yeah, there's always a typical amount of weather days built in that we haven't.
So far, we're doing one.
Correct, and we haven't had to touch those weather days yet. So.
And then my second question is, when will the various playing fields be done, softball, practice fields?
So those will be done the summer of 2021. And so the diamond field softball will be complete then. The six new tennis courts will be done, and we're fairly confident they're not going to sink and are excited about that. And then the turfed practice field will be done then as well. So by August of 2021.
Yeah.
Yes, but for the softball field, which will have grass turf, after it's put in, there may be a time where we have to wait for the grass to be fully in
rooted
place before we can play on it.
Tim.
Yeah, it's all very positive and shows continued, excellent project management. I'm sure we all appreciate. Just curious whether the huge rain event that we had on July 8th, whether that caused any adjustments to the overall stormwater plan for the site?
I don't think
so.
No, it didn't.
It was certainly a first test of not the system, because it's certainly not fully engaged and not in, but of just what the whole is going to do, essentially.
Yeah.
But we actually just for double check purposes, we went back to the design team, had them look at it, and we're still really confident in the system that we're gonna have in place. So no issues there.
It's going to be the new normal.
I think that's a really good point, is looking at what is the new average rainfall going to be over time. And one of the things that you'll see in the solutions that we've presented, and Tim, this, but maybe not everybody, is we're trying to do as many natural stormwater mitigation practices as possible so that we don't have a lot of vaults in the ground. So you'll see rain gardens, and in fact, I don't know if we have a picture of it, but yeah, well, actually, you can see here, these are actually stormwater management mitigation tools that are going to be in place. And then all along the Henderson side, too, there will be some. And then on the back side, by the fields, there will also be a significant number of gardens that will capture and utilize that groundwater or rainwater differently. But I do hear your concern, and it is something that we ultimately, I hope, are planning for in a positive way. But it is concerning.
Are those the newer renderings of the gym and the theater? Are those up on the website?
They're going to go up today.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
These are hot off the press
from
our meeting
last night.
I'm seeing many of these. I'm like, whoa, those are new.
Yeah, yeah.
The other thing I wanted to compliment you all, I was at an event a couple weeks ago where a city council person was talking about some challenges they've had with their projects in the past.
Mm.
And some that are upcoming that are challenging. And they've used you as an example of a well-run project. And this enormous project, the schools are doing, also having the owner's rep was such a great use of our money to protect us, make sure that we're under budget and on time and all that. So compliments to both of you all.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
We appreciate that. I know that having Brailsford and Dunleavey and specifically Deisy and Jack on our team has been extraordinarily helpful. It's allowed us to kind of walk and chew gum, because we do have schools to run to, and the instructional program is equally important. But we, to be fair, we're one third of the way through, and we still got two thirds of the way to go. So, I'm feeling good about where we are, and we'll continue.
So, Peter, I can just add from a school board standpoint, Deisy has been amazing. The briefings that she gives us. I mean, first of all, she's incredibly smart, but just so diligent and so dedicated. And I just know from a school board standpoint, whenever she explains stuff to it, first of all, we can actually understand what she's saying, so we appreciate that. But also, her attention to detail and the way she's just checking out the boxes has just been really incredible and gives us such a huge level of comfort, so we appreciate that.
You're all very kind. I definitely appreciate the kind words. It's been a pleasure working with everyone, and I look forward to continued engagement over the next 2 years. But I also want to give credit, you know, just generally to the city, to the community, to central office, Dr. Noonan, Kristen, Trish, and everybody involved. It's just been a very collaborative effort, and I think that's really what's made it successful. Like, we've done our part, and we've, you know, done our, what you hired us to do, but just the engagement and the collaboration has been a breath of fresh air.
This sounds like a great opportunity to showcase to others what a new modern school of the future could look like. I also think it could be a way to showcase the thoughtful use of technology. And so I'm just wondering, what have you taken into account the issue that is on the horizon of that potential health effects of wireless technology? Cell phone towers in the school or that kind of thing. And has the school been wired for any Ethernet? Because that, you know, I'm foreseeing that there are going to need to be safe areas in the school. Kids are there all day, as is the staff. And I'm wondering, is there a way to address this issue of, you know, from a construction standpoint as well, to have options to wire the school, to educate people about putting your phones into airplane mode during school, because that really shuts down the communication from cell phones with everyone has one. And another point would be for the plot of land that's next door, the 10-acre project.
The economic development.
You know, to be sure that they're not going to just put up a cell tower right there. I mean, these are sort of a lot of issues that I'm throwing out, but
sure.
I just wonder what thought has gone into the wiring. And one last thing, so you mentioned solar panels.
Mm-hmm.
Solar, making use of solar energy is fantastic. There is a problem, though, converting it to AC power, where you don't want it to be in, creates magnetic fields, which all biological systems are sensitive to. So that's something to take into account as well. Where are these panels? How close are people going to be? Those kinds of issues are really concerning to me and to a lot of people, at least in my circles.
Well, I'll answer some of it, and some of it, you know, happy to continue the conversation. First is, you know, thanks for recognizing that this building can be a model. I do believe that it is a model of what schools of the future can look like, and I think that the community's input in helping us sort of envision what it could look like has been extraordinary. So one of the things you'll see in this building is a lot of light, a lot of space, a lot of opportunities for collaboration and the like. With respect to the technology, there is going to be some hardwire and there's going to be quite a bit of wireless. And one of the things that we look at is, one, the research that is out there and sort of what is industry standard. And so we'll be paying attention to that as we sort of move through that. We will be sure to ask any provider of solar, sort of what their research is around the questions that you've raised, because I think it'd be good to know sort of what their take on it is. And but I do anticipate that there'll be quite a bit of technology use in this building that will be both hardwired and also wireless. I can't answer the question about the cell, like a cell phone tower on the 10-acre site. What I can say is that, you know, those decisions of what happens with respect to cell phone towers typically are dealt with through a special use permit from the city and would require city approval. And so anytime one comes forward, they would certainly go through the process of determining how to move that through. So.
That would be part of the site plan review. If there was a tower there, it would get a lot of attention.
Yeah, Tim's on the Planning Commission and Andy too, and they definitely would be paying attention to the to any cell tower.
The device that converts from DC to AC is called an inverter.
Thank you.
I've been reading articles on solar systems for a dozen years, and fortunately, I haven't read anything about EMF or electromagnetic radiation being a problem for the inverters, but. Certainly agree. It's an evolving issue, and I think it merits continued monitoring.
I think it's magnetic fields that it creates that you actually can't shield against. So the real thing is the distance, which is hard to do with a concrete.
Yeah, we're all kind of a big guinea pig in a way for all kinds of devices, lights, and everything else.
Absolutely.
Jack.
One thing I'll add. We have made the decision for the project to not include a cellular DAS system, which is an antenna system that repeats the signal. We have not. We do have a radio DAS system for emergencies, for the fire and EMS responders, but we have not included a DAS system that will repeat cell phone signals at this time. So that's one thing that I guess. To your point, that's been not included in the project.
Well, I just want to be honest and fair with your time too. We said about an hour, so we're right at an hour. And just to say, I think it's an hour, right? We said 9:30, 10:30. I lose track of time sometimes. my staff will tell you. But just want to say thank you all for being here and being part of the conversation. Again, we hope to do this once a month, and we'll certainly get more information out and, again, try to do it some morning, some afternoon, so we can accommodate as many people, because this is going to be in lieu of that Sunday series that had traditionally been in place. So with that, we want to say thank you, and if you have any other questions or concerns, GMHS, what is the email? We'll put it up here again, but would invite you to write to us if you have any questions, thoughts, or concerns moving forward, or certainly just talk to us, because we're here. So thanks.